I'm delighted to welcome our final panelist, Uzma Z. Rifki. He courses a number of disciplines that are important to the question of decoloniality, so ranging from archaeology, ancient studies, contemporary urban studies, through to sort of questions around sort of contemporary mechanisms of conflict, but also has a methodological framework through which she's also working frequently through co-participatory mechanisms and methods for which she is valued and recognized globally. Thank you.
Can everyone hear me?
So now I can hear myself too. So I do tend to speak fast, and so I took some time last night to cut out half of my paper so that I could force myself to speak slowly, and also to keep in mind that because English is not a first language for everyone here, that I've done what I usually don't let my students do, which is put a lot of text. So for some key passages, I've put the text up as well so that you can follow along just in case. And that may not have been the most important piece, but that's what I thought was pretty significant to me last night at 1 a.m. So, hey, should be great. So, good morning. And I'd like to begin, this is very important for me that I do this in many different spaces, is acknowledging and thanking the indigenous community.
That's a bit of pain in the ass. Do we want to sort it?
No. I'm happy to deal with pain in the asses as I go along. I would like to begin by acknowledging and thanking the Sami upon whose land we are, in fact, standing, and of course, the organizers for the invitation to speak as a part of this symposium and the institutions that have supported them, our travel and our stay. So as you can see here, the title of my talk is Decolonizing Colonial Desires, which could have easily just have said Decolonizing Museums, because museums are precisely that, monuments of colonial desire. As you can imagine, I have a lot to say about this, but I will only present three salient points related to decolonizing colonial desire in the limited time that I have. And so I'm just going to put these three points up so that we have some sense of where we're going in this talk. And as I said, I do have a lot that I would like to say about this. And what I've done is at the end of the presentation, I've given you a whole series of publications where I've expounded on these same issues, so you can always look at those. So, and with all my work, I tend to have a sort of main point, but it always has a subtext because, you know, as an archaeologist, I'm very interested in what's underneath. So the first one is contemporaneity of colonialism, and the subtext for that is the deep relationship to capitalism, racism, and patriarchy. The second one I'm going to talk about today is the impetus for decolonization, and that, for me, the subtext there, very important one, is contending with epistemic laziness. And this idea of epistemic laziness is something that philosopher Jose Medina has worked out in a book called Epistemologies of Resistance, which I highly recommend, a really great book. And the third and final one is decolonization as care, for which the subtext is love is political, slow down, and the idea of speculative futures. And so it's one of those very odd moments for me personally right now, because it's one of the first international presentations I'm doing to speak about decolonization, as my country, the US, has just elected a fascist and misogynist who is slowly building a racist government. This is a setback, to put it mildly, for many of us who have been working for generations on anti-colonial and decolonizing efforts, as so much of what we have been working on is now in jeopardy for seeming like it is too politically correct, or about people's feelings, or that the work that we do is just to make sure we don't offend people. So first off, I was raised to think it was inappropriate to hurt people's feelings anyways, right? So to me, that as an argument doesn't make any sense, because it's actually not a really nice thing to hurt people's feelings. But that's actually not what the key point here is, right? And this is very important, because what underlines that criticism of just something hurting people's feelings is that people don't recognize what colonization, racism, misogyny actually do. It is important for us to understand that the act of decolonization is not just about people's feelings. It is about our bodies, our minds, our lives, our pasts, and our futures. And so if we begin, you know, on our 3 points, the relationship and link between new late liberal or late capitalist models of racism and colonization are deep and complex. The racialized lives of people around the world today owe much of their condition to a history of colonization that links economics as capital to human bodies, landscapes, and forms of understanding of self and other. Colonization was and continues to be an incredibly violent form of control that interlinks patriarchy, capitalism, and the project of nationalism. And there's no better place to locate this discussion than the museum. The museum was a place where I was raised in. Like, literally, my parents would just leave me there in the morning and then pick me up at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. It was fantastic. And it's a place where I continue to work as a professional. As an archaeologist who specializes in the third millennium BCE, I have found that my work cannot be just or equitable if I do not contend with the museum. If I do not question the coloniality of the museum, my work will always be complicit with the colonizing mission of the museum. And in that questioning, my archaeological research becomes contemporary, insofar as what makes it contemporary is, as the Delhi-based Rux Media Collective would argue, the ability to step out of time to critically evaluate the past and the future. This is something that Rux has talked about quite a bit, and they've borrowed a lot of these ideas from Agamben as well. This is kind of like a conversation. And so what happens when you step out of time is that you enter into a space of stories and storytelling, which sometimes can be emancipatory, but can also be where stories condition your internalized schema of being. And you begin to realize that so much of how you learn to live in museums came from reading about how you were supposed to be. And to realize much of this and to contend with my self-colonial conditioning, I have had to rely upon the works of Fanon, James Baldwin, and the visioning prowess of speculative fiction writers such as Octavia Butler. But we're not at the storytelling part of the paper yet. I must first tell you about my own discipline. Archaeology can no longer feign ignorance. Archaeologists are fully aware of the imbricated and deeply colonial, racist, and sexist epistemology of our field. It is also commonly understood among archaeologists that without modernity, archaeology as we know it would not exist. But then again, insofar as modernity may claim history-making through the construction of disciplines such as archaeology, it is also important to recognize that history was made for certain reasons. That history, the deep past and or contemporary, is molded and shaped in the service of the nation, whether it is there to contest it or promote it. In engaging with the nation, it continues to reiterate its power. Given that the project of modernity was linked to the making of history through archaeology as the making of the nation, it is also then just as important to recognize the very complex and entangled relationships between coloniality, patriarchy, capitalism, and the project of modernity. So very simply, if in fact this can be a simple solution or a simple equation, patriarchy, coloniality, and capitalism are ontologically constitutive of modernity, and thus so are archaeology and the nation. So here, just in case we're not all sort of aware of what the significant distinctions are between ontology and epistemology. Ontology is kind of this philosophical concept which has to do with an essence of things, right? That the thing itself has a certain kind of property. So when we're talking about the property of modernity, the essence of modernity, deeply embedded in that property of itself is patriarchy, is coloniality, is capitalism, and also linked then is archaeology of the nation, right? Because these are projects of modernity. As compared to epistemology, which is the study of how we, or the ways in which knowledge is built. And so we have different epistemologies, different ways of knowing, different ways of seeing, different ways of doing. But oftentimes we think of ontological certainties as being consistent and universal, when in fact many scholars have argued that there are many different ontological certainties that exist as well. Right? So just a quick recap, just in case you weren't part of the ontological term that happened earlier. All right, so let's move into artifacts. Artifacts have a long history of having been constructed through discourses of desire, fetish, and collection. The excitement or thrill of holding, touching, and possessing a relic or an artifact belies a desire to expand systems of control to encompass time. The creation of colonial desire for the artifact links coloniality and collections, as well as the manner in which the post-colonial nation has dealt with the artifact. And this has actually been dealt with in many different publications, so I'm not the first one to talk about this, nor will I be the last, most likely. The artifact emerges as a desired object, not only in terms of collection, but following, and arguably prompted by, that as the primary object of archaeological inquiry. So in some sense, just asking the question of the artifact makes it a significant piece of our history and history making, and as an object of desire that all of us want to ask of that object something. And so what happens then to the archaeologist when the artifact itself becomes the vessel of colonization? In the articulation of betrayal, what happens when those of us in the colonies grow up and realize that one of our childhood books are racist and bring to bear explicit expressions of coloniality? Deep in our childhood, these stories that I read in the museums, taught us how to behave and what is normalized based on an artifact of pleasure. Now, I bring this up because it was only 2 days ago that I realized that Pippi Longstocking was Swedish. I was like, what? But I grew up reading Pippi Longstocking, right? And so I just wanted, I don't know if you can read the quote there, right here. And Pippi in the South Seas was one of my favorite books, right? So just think of the like enormity of this betrayal, right? Of growing up with this. You're right, she said sadly, I am lying. And then later on in that same text in the first book, she says, but I forget it now and then. And for that matter, let me tell you that in the Congo, there is not a single person who tells the truth, right? So it very, a clear accepted norm of lying, because she is only nine. I don't know if you remember the story, if you read it as much as I did. She's only nine, right? And this idea that, yes, she knows she's lying. She knows it. And she continues it. So for a child who's reading this at probably also at nine, I can't remember how old I was at the time, there is this sort of reiterative sense of people in the Congo lying, right? And that it's okay to lie about people in the Congo lying. And then, of course, I read comics as well, and here's one of my favorites of, speaking of the Congo, in South Asia, we call him Tintin, because we're not French. And so here, what I think is so significant is this idea of getting a boy in a car, and that Snowy, the white little dog, is reminding Tintin of his mosquito net. But most importantly, Snowy always kind of appeared as this sort of figure of this sort of moral character that would constantly, or this background, this subtext almost, right? So here's Tintin talking to a young man, and he says, you know, okay, we've agreed, Coco, right? You know, accompany us through the journey in the Congo, yes, master. And then here's Snowy saying he doesn't look very bright. So now I have in my head not only that everyone in the Congo lies, but that they're also not very bright. Right? And so this is the deep betrayal of artifacts of pleasure that I have had to contend with as an archaeologist looking towards this past and towards a contemporary past to get some sense of what sorts of discourses underlie much of what is happening within these artifacts and within what we might consider to be museum curation. So now, this of course, being very personal, leads me to this another very personal project, the impetus for decolonization. Am I out of time?
Yeah.
All right. So, the act of decolonization requires active steps to redress past injustices related to colonialism. It is complicated to decolonize museums because of the deep and intimate relationships colonial states have to their collections as monuments to nation building and authorized heritage. These relationships held by majority populations and governance are locally specific. However, what unites the various geographies is the history of colonization and the continued violence on othered bodies in those locales. These othered bodies are marked by racism and ethnicism, and it is that colonial difference that Anval by Hanno and Walter Mignolo have argued was required for a colonial power to be fully recognized, and for what modernity was to base as its existence, right? And this is this idea of colonial difference, and this is the decoloniality that you were referring to earlier, as compared to the active praxis of decolonization. Both are similar, but are have different kinds of modes of operation. It is that knowledge that leads to this impetus of decolonization. So for the purposes of this project, because I have different processes of decolonization that are at play, but for now, I conceive of the process of decolonization as deconstructing systems of power. That is to say, it can be the process by which the internal and systemic contradictions, and here I'm using archaeology specifically as my example, within archaeological methodology, stemming from a colonial history, are made transparent. The post-colonial critique necessitates a reinterpretation of the prehistoric past, beginning with an examination of the most basic of all archaeological practice, the collection of archaeological data. Providing archaeological methodology and interpretations with nuance, the post-colonial critique mediates between a history of archaeology as a colonial product and contemporary archaeological research. This critique emerged as a particular response to the production of knowledge about people, specifically how colonized peoples were written about, historicized, imagined, and treated as existing on the margins in all aspects of the Occidental and civilized. So now, why is all of that important, right? So where does that leave us? Is it argument enough to claim that our ignorance of unintended consequences of our actions grants us ethical permission to continue to act ignorantly? I would argue no. Right? Straight up, no. That is not enough. It is epistemically unjust the moment we participate in bodies of ignorance that we have inherited. Archaeology's heritage is colonial, which impacts the manner in which it is practiced globally. It is deeply colonial on every level of knowledge construction around the world, and it behooves us to think through that impact. Archaeology may argue that the construction of these knowledges was already in place, but through our participation, they are activated. Whether we act on it or fail to act against it, whether we know it or not, and whether we will it or not, right? And I'm using archaeology because I don't want to point fingers out there. I'm going to first point fingers at me and my own discipline. But I kind of feel like we could change the word archaeology to kind of maybe write about, you know, curatorial practice, ethnographic museums, art practice. You know, there's a lot that's there. So relying on older systems of power reflects the scarcity of time and energy required to negotiate and renegotiate our positions of power and privilege when we enter into the field as researchers. And such economies are symptomatic of complacency. Right? So now, not only have I called my field ignorant, but I've also called it complacent. Most decisions to maintain and reify power structures are not maliciously intended, but are byproducts of prioritizing research over inequality, disenfranchisement, and in a callous sense, prioritizing our research practice over the present, past, or future of others. And so this brings me to my final point, to think about how we might engage with the politics of care, or as Alejandro Javier has talked about, a regime of care, and in the way I'm thinking about it, think of decolonization as care. You'll notice that towards the end of my talk, I have a lot more text because I know it gets harder to kind of follow after a while. So I thought about that. Just want to let you know, I'm thinking about you guys. Self-recognition, knowledge, and reclamation are at the heart of how one might methodologically approach decolonization praxis. And this is really where care is paramount. In our contemporary moment, so much text. In our contemporary moment, we have lost the ability to take out the time to write, to draw, to wonder, to let our curiosity dictate a research pattern. More and more, we are propelled into a system that requires all labor, to produce at breakneck speed, suggesting that somehow the survival of the fittest model of labor capitalism is achieved with a lack of all human needs, food, sleep, air, love, etc. The late capitalist model has alienated the human body to such a degree that we are no longer allowed to be human to be considered successful. One of the ways I consider decolonization to be useful is that it forces the hand of alienation to move. It actually removes the clutches of that form of control over self and control over body and labor. In some measure, that is precisely what we want, but it is still a very privileged position. I have been so disciplined into my subjectivity as an academic that even when I have slowed down and allowed for care and mindfulness to enter into my own work, I have produced an enormous amount of material. Perhaps even because of it, I have produced more work because I am happier working. So in some sense, even though I'm trying to contest and resist this system, I'm actually fulfilling the goal of the late capitalist neoliberal academic systems agenda. Right? So here's the double edge that I'm kind of stuck between, the rock and the hard place. So what became significant for me was the reclaiming of a self that is mired in a late capitalist lifestyle. And this is one that requires thoughtfulness, a sense of self-care, and a commitment to time as something to give, not to spend. A radical change in praxis does not always mean a dramatic and drastic change. Sometimes the self-awareness may result in a small material or spatial shift, but it is enough to create a mindful balance. The dramatic quality of the change may be intangible, but palpable. In all of my experience, however, the mode of resistance has only ever worked through collaboration, finding allies and solidarity with others. It is through different kinds of practices and alignments that one can contest some of the conditions within which we are working. This can maintain one's livelihood and sense of self. And so, through alliances and creating kin with others, human, non-humans, and here I'm referring to a lot of the radical feminist literature, such as Donna Haraway's work, more recent work, and Beth Pavanelli's work. So through these alliances and creating kin with others, human and non-human, we maintain and protect ourselves. And ultimately, that care for and with others is also self-care. Once we recognize ourselves, we begin to recognize our positions and how our positions may be at the expense of others, be those others human or non-human. Once we recognize that we are placed in various systems and ways to keep us moving in place, we stop and then slowly realign our ways of experience, and our praxis experiences radical change, one in which we might recognize decolonization as care. Thank you.
Thank you, Uzma. Does anyone have any questions or observations or comments that they'd like to direct to Uzma and to content of her presentation? Okay, I'll take you first, Sara, then you, Frederick.
Hi.
I can see you up there.
Do you collaborate much directly with museums? Could you tell me about that?
Okay, let me repeat the question for the room. So the question was,
do I collaborate directly with museums, and can I talk a bit about that? Is that about right? So I've worked in museums, so in that sense it is collaborative. I've run grants. And this is with the archaeological and ethnographic museums at the University of Pennsylvania. Now I tend to work more with contemporary art museums and community-based sort of museums. So the most recent collaboration and an ongoing work that I've done is with the Queens Museum. The Queens Museum in New York has a very robust community programming and very social justice-oriented work. And so with my students, I do a lot of work with them. So yes, does that answer your question?
Yeah, I suppose I'll draw you out a little bit more in as much as I'd like to come to Queens and see that work that you're doing there, definitely. But could you tell me a bit more about how your ideas of care and radical change
Yeah. So I'm very lucky in that Queen's already had, I don't know if you are familiar with Tom Finkelpearl's work, but he was an artist and curator, now is working within the city of New York. But when he became the director of the Queen's Museum, he's done a lot with public art and sort of has a very clear sense of social justice, right? And a clear sense of racial justice as well. When he began working at Queen's many years ago, he actually went into the community and worked on bringing community voices into the museum and changing, not just as, because oftentimes you hear about that in relationship to audience participation, like, let's build new audiences, right? It's not about the new audiences, it was actually about new curatorial programming. And he hired, like, it wasn't just focus groups where he'll just give them pizza, he actually hired people. Right? So hiring people from the community, I thought, was a first step. So the reason I bring up his work and then Jayashree Abhichandani's work, who was one of the first programmers, and then now Prerna Reddy, who's been doing this work for quite some time and quite successfully, is that these women and these and this curator were able to actually create a space of care, right? And a space where it actually mattered that what sort of issues were actually happening in the community in Queens, so they needed a health center, or they needed books, or they needed a library, to then work with contemporary artists to actually develop those kinds of projects, right? Or to think about the significance of blood pressure, right? Or the significance of diabetes in certain communities, and what artists can do who are dealing with those issues as well. And so I've also known Jayashree and Prerna and all these people for a while, so I already had a lot of those progressive networks in place. And so as we all grew up, I guess, and you know, some of us became academics, some of us became artists, some of us became curators, we continued those aspects of solidarity, right? And we continued to work with each other, and we continued to promote each other. So that museum, I think, is rare. Right, in that its ability to talk so openly about radical change and care, and its desire to do that. When I've had conversations at other museums, there's a sense of, like, they're not quite sure what to do with this language, right? And they're not quite sure what I mean. So either they just hand me stuff and say, here, tell us what you want in terms of a budget, or I just don't work with them, right? Like, I'm not interested in, I'm too old for this bullshit, you know? So if someone comes up to me and says, I don't understand why this is important, I'm like, okay, well, whatever you do, come back. I'm still here. I don't need to teach you. You know, if you want to take one of my classes, you can. You can read some of my work. But I it's not my responsibility anymore to teach you these things. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
That doesn't sound very caring. Nurturing of me. It actually sounds quite bitchy of me. But you know, sometimes you've got to be a little bit
clear.
Yeah. And to the point, yeah.
Frederick, your question, please.
Yeah, thank you.
Oh, so many questions from up there. Hello.
Any questions from above?
Questions from above. The meta discursive questions.
This one for sure.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, thanks a lot. I really appreciate this idea of the museum as a monument for colonial desire, old colonial desire. But I'm curious about your concept of desire here, because it seems to me like in colonial modernity, the notion of care, and caring, affects caring for the other and giving the other the language of the power and so on, to be able to care for the other is as we know, it has a very problematic history. And then we have people today, like Donahue, try to reinvent the new notion of how to deal with otherness or deal with human and non-human agents, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
But in your practice, when you use the word care and want to decolonialize, or whatever
mm-hmm.
we call it, this specific desire, how do you understand the desire behind it? Is it the desire to, as I understood it, it was a kind of desire to create a new relationship between knowledge and truth, or ontology and epistemology, or like,
what's going on?
Yeah. What's going on in your concept of desire?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so just to make sure I've understood, and maybe to translate for a bit for the non-meta-discursive layer. So if we think about, so it's the question of desire, but in relationship to how care may be decolonized, because it too, linked to desire, is problematic.
Mm.
Is that kind of a,
mm-hmm.
Okay. So a very good question, so thank you for that. Now, it's important to recognize the distinction between being patronizing and caring, right? The desire that we have to help the world as an American, I have been brought up wanting to liberate and bring democracy to the world in that gesture. And that is not care, right? That is a colonial, that is a desire to be the one who is the sort of main nation, the main exporter of an imperial sensibility, right? So in that sense, one, and it has been, you know, the issues with these with these theoretical frameworks is that they get co-opted often by the right. It's like, well, we're caring for you. We are here to liberate you. Like, why are you still resisting us, right? So if you think about Standing Rock, great example, right? So what has the mayor done there? That he has issued, a governor, he has issued an emergency evacuation notice, right? Saying that I care about you, right? I don't want you to die in freezing weather, and so you must evacuate now. That is not care. That is a co-optation of a certain kind of discourse of care in order to ensure that a colonial mission can continue, right? That's indigenous land, those are protesters, those are peaceful protesters, and they're on their own frickin' land, right? So the question comes up of, well, when you say that, like in a rational sense, you can't say, well, no, you can't care for the protesters. Like, how would you say that? How would you tell the governor, no, we don't want you to care for these people? But the question is, what kind of care? What is the impetus for that care, right? The impetus for that care is not one in which there's solidarity or in which he may actually even step up and say, there will be no pipeline. That would be care, right, in a decolonized sense. Now, the desire there, for me, the link between the desire and the care, is very much linked to sort of a very sort of capitalist desire to make sure that this pipeline goes on, right? And the fear we have, and I'm just giving a real example because I'm kind of working on it right now, is that there's been now a lawsuit that's being gone from either the Army Corps to the energy pipeline people. And what that's going to do is it's going to delay any decision until Trump gets into office. Trump has a significant amount of money invested in this energy company, right? So, that laughter and the holding of the head, that's what we're all doing right now. So there's care that is a decolonized, a sort of an act of decolonization and solidarity and building and a sort of kind of a different kind of radical feminist epistemology. And then there is one that is just, you know, patronizing or colonial. And the desire for me has more to do with the desire to have, right, to hold. And that comes, that links very well into capitalism and this desire to just keep wanting rather than sharing or giving. That's a very simplistic way. Does that kind of answer your question? I mean, it's a very complicated.
Yeah, I think it's one answer, but I mean, if we understand the museum as a place where lack is regulated in a different ways. I mean, you brought up people on stocking, you brought up different ways of regulating the subjectivities in the museum,
mm-hmm.
whether it's dogs or humans, whether they can read what's going on or not.
Mm.
And I'm interested in, like, in your practice in the museum setting, if the museum is the monument for colonial desire. Do you have like an example of how you deregulate or re-regulate the way lack is regulated in the museum?
We throw dance parties.
Okay.
Progressive dance. Progressive house.
It's a great
way to do it. And we eat a lot. We eat a lot. So the Skype people. It's very important to eat and it's very important to dance.
Okay.
Yeah. And each, like, that's a very quick answer.
Yeah.
It's a kind of a sort of a placeholder for many other things
yeah.
that we do. But a lot of it does come with disruption, but in it, in terms of aesthetics of sound, or if we think about it, you know, politics of the dance floor, there are different ways in which we can do that. But we do in fact take over museum spaces. But every museum is different, right? And a lot of my own practice, in the last decade, I've actually moved out of the museums and trying to find, because people have been wanting to push me back into museums, and I've been wanting to get out and find public space, which I have not found anywhere. Like, it's less and less public space. So if I'm ever standing, like, there was this one time when I was trying to do a class in Lower Manhattan. So I took my students out to the historic districting office, and we were standing there. There were 12 students and I. And we were stopped by the cops. And they said, you're not allowed to assemble. Do you have a permit? And I was like, it's a class. We're talking about, you know, like, you cannot assemble, right? So it's not you, anyone. It's you cannot assemble, right? So we moved from there to a different spot in the park. We were asked again to move. We moved to the subway entrance. We were asked to move again. We moved into the subway, into the metro. At the station, the conductors told us, not the conductors, the security at the police who stand at subways asked us to move. And so I had my class in the subway car, which was amazing, because it was like super public. Everyone in the subway car got involved, and it was all about surveillance. So it was like, hey, I could not have planned this better. But that public space no longer exists for me, right? So I've actually moved out of the museum in my own practice in search of ways to disrupt colonial desire in other spaces.
Thank you.
So
it's
much.
Nice seeing you.
Thank you.